This is Dr. Karen Pagnano. She teaches here at Bridgewater and over in the Tinsley Center. And she's going to be speaking on gymnastics for all, a child-centered approach. Yes.
Thank you. It's great to be here this morning. And today, the focus of our lesson is looking at gymnastics and focusing on a child-centered approach. And we need to think about gymnastics as a way of achieving some of the physical, cognitive, and affective objectives that you have for your students here in the clinic. And the purpose of today's presentation is really threefold. First is to share the conceptual underpinnings of a gymnastics model called Kidnastics. And Kidnastics is a child-centered approach to gymnastics, which allows the teacher to challenge each student at their own level by manipulating the practice environment, by then sequencing movement, and then performing movement. Kidnastics is a hybrid model of gymnastics that really combines artistic gymnastics or Olympic gymnastics, probably the traditional way you think about gymnastics, and educational gymnastics. And it brings the ideas together in a coherent fashion that's relatively simple to understand and really facilitates the learning process for students. The second purpose of the presentation today is to give you, to share with you a wide variety of movements, stunts, balances that may expand your notion of what gymnastics means and how you can use gymnastics when you're working with students with disabilities. And then the final purpose is to allow you to experience a brief kidnastic lesson, and it'll allow you to think about how kidnastics can be an inclusive approach to teaching and learning when working with students with a wide range of abilities. I want to share with you a little bit of my own biography so that one maybe has some credibility as I stand up here and speak with you, and just so you understand where I've come in my thinking about gymnastics. I've really made a professional journey from artistic gymnastics or Olympic gymnastics to a kidnastic approach over the last 18 years. I've worked as a private school gymnastics coach, and now I'm currently a teacher educator here at Bridgewater State College. As a private gymnastics coach and as a high school gymnastics coach, I often had all my athletes do the same skill the same way, which is really what artistic gymnastics demands, is one right way to do something. As a high school physical education teacher, I became somewhat frustrated. I was challenged to meet the diverse needs of my students during the gymnastics unit. Differences in body type, their skill level, demanded I find a way to really differentiate my instruction for my students. I really thought there couldn't be just one right way to move. I wanted all my students to experience a creative process of developing routines and sequencing movement. I began to use questions to prompt a creative process. For example, I might ask students, how many ways can you roll? We didn't all practice a full roll at the same time, we all explored rolling, and there was a range of responses that would be appropriate for students. I may have thrown out a question like, show me three different ways that you can balance on two different body parts, which allowed students to, again, show a range of response that really allowed all students to be successful. And it's that type of thinking that I want to bring to you today as you think about presenting gymnastic skills. At Bridgewater State College, I use a kidnastic approach in our gymnastics activity course that I teach. In class, gymnastics is really all about exploring movement in relationship to equipment, space, and people. I have found the social nature of movement is really important in motivating the students in my class as well. So you might ask, what is kidnastics? Kidnastics is actually a term that was coined by an educator from SUNY Brockport. And so it's a relatively unique word. But we want to think about kidnastics as a type of gymnastics that is, as I said before, combining educational gymnastics and some of the more traditional movements in Olympic gymnastics. I want you to understand two ideas about kidnastics today. First, it's a way to organize movement. It's simple. You can think of gymnastics movements really as five categories. You can think about rolling actions, jumping actions, balancing, vaulting, and hanging and climbing. If you think about gymnastics, that's really inclusive of all the movements that we do. We'll have sort of a special definition of vaulting, so you'll see how that is inclusive of quite a few different movements. And second, I want you to realize that kidnastics is also a way to organize a lesson. And there's a specific sequence to a lesson, which includes practicing skills in isolation, and then practicing the skills in a variety of environments. And as we talk today, you're going to understand a little bit more about what I mean by different environments. Today, we're not going to really explore numerous environments just by the virtue of how long it takes to set up all these different things. So we're going to do a fairly limited approach to what different environments we use. And then it involves sequencing movement. You do things on your own first, you do something with a partner next, and then you may do something with a group. And then finally, there's a performance aspect to kidnastics. Here you see a few Bridgewater State College students in our final performance there. So let's examine the kidnastic approach a little bit more in depth. First, you manipulate the environment to assist in learning basic movement themes. Remember, our movement themes were rolling, vaulting, hanging, etc. You want to use uphills, downhills, so the cheese-shaped mats we're talking about there, mat stacks, hoops, beams, wide and narrow, anything that can make a movement either more difficult or easier for a student. Second, you want to practice movement skills in a variety of the environments. For example, it's not good enough just to be able to roll on a flat surface. What we want to do is we want to produce movers who can roll in a variety of situations. And it truly, truly expands what we call their movement vocabulary. For example, in this picture, the students are rolling off the ropes. That was one of the tasks they had to show rolling, and they chose to roll actually off the ropes. And then third, sequencing and performing are key aspects of kidnastics. Sequencing requires a motor plan, and then cooperative behaviors that you need to use to work with a partner. Performance is an opportunity to celebrate the quality of movement and is done on a regular basis, usually within each lesson. So one of the things I talk a little bit about today is this notion of manipulating the environment. And one of the things that is interesting about manipulating the environment is it really takes a teacher out of the role of telling students what to do every moment of a lesson. If you can set up the environment so that the child, by virtue of responding to a question, can be in the right body position, then really you've given one, the child some control and power about how their body moves. For example, if you want a child to practice curling their back, if you have them hold a Nerf ball in their stomach as they roll, you don't have to tell them all that much about how to move their body. Just say, I want you to keep that ball right in your belly as you're moving back and forth, and you're going to see the correct response. So a unique feature of kidnastics is that the learning environment shapes the movement response. Changing and adapting the environment to make the task easy or more difficult allows the student to find an appropriate challenge level. Furthermore, the focus is presenting the task first in one environment and then extending it through practice in many environments. Environmental manipulation allows the teacher to provide for individual differences by modifying or reconfiguring the practice environment. And really, my charge to you will be, as today we just barely scratched the surface of what you might do with changing the environment, I want to open the door in your thinking that you can get your students to do things simply by changing where they practice it. And that skill can be easier if you use, say, a wider base. It can be more difficult if you do something on a narrow base. But you need to be thinking about how that plays into it. And you have a rich environment here to work in that really allows for modification. So I want you to think about creating this environment. Even when you leave here, what might you use to create a really exciting environment for students to work in? And kidnastics equipment is not limited to the traditional apparatus of ball, beam, bars, floor, rings. It includes anything that students can move on, move over, move through, hold on to. So if you look on that list, there's quite a range of things that you might use. Things from mats, hoops, benches, chairs, tires, boxes, poles, bars, hurdles. You can read through, but really anything that you could put in the gymnasium that then students are moving on, over, through, that will influence their movement pattern. One thing we need to think about, though, is that you want to create an environment to shape the movement that you want your students to practice. So any environment isn't okay. You need to think about what you're trying to accomplish, what are your goals, and so therefore, why is your environment set up as it is? So you must think about what you want your students to learn, their current level of achievement, and then set up the environment accordingly. For example, if one of my objectives is to improve dynamic balance, then I need to create an environment that requires students to use dynamic balance. This may include beams, benches, tires, and mat stacks, depending on the student's abilities. As I said before, the major movement themes in Kidnastics would be rolling, jumping, balancing, vaulting, hanging, and climbing. You may recognize some people there. In relationship to lesson design, Kidnastics is a three-step learning process, which includes practicing, sequencing, and performing. And here you're seeing a picture of performance, and the students are using some benches, a low beam for their performance, and their movement is sequenced. So the first part, and today you'll have a chance to do a lot of practicing. I'm going to practice some little parts of a whole bunch of different movement themes today. First, you practice single skills or themes in different environments. Today, what I'm going to be doing, because I'm really going to try to share with you a whole repertoire of things that you might do in a theme, I'm going to present a specific skill. Like I might say, let's do a log roll. If we are practicing a theme, I might more broadly state that we're going to work on rolling, and I want you to practice five different rolls. So you can present something thematically, or you can do it sort of with a skill-based way. You do still want to adapt for individual needs as you throw out your tasks that you're exploring within each theme. And the order would be practice the skill individually, practice it with a partner, and then practice it with a group, which adds the complexity of the movement. And here you do see some students that are both vaulting over the vault at the same time, sequencing their movement. So the Bridgewater State College students certainly up the level on their responses to some Kidnastic routines. So step two now is going to be in the lesson design is sequencing movement. And I think that when you think about the notion of sequencing movement, think about what that adds to your child's movement repertoire. If they can link movements together in a smooth fashion, if they can then do that and time their movement and work in unison with another person, that's really giving them quite a command of their movement. Far more than if you just, let's just say, okay, log roll once on the ground. Oh, you can log roll. You know, but can you log roll at the same time as someone else does? Can you log roll and go into and out of that in a smooth way? It really expands the child's notion of, or the child's ability to be a skilled mover. So sequencing is a key part, and you can probably think through, too, the social nature of sequencing and how children will need to communicate in order to time their movements. And that tends to be very motivating when students work together. And I certainly found that with my college students here at Bridgewater State College. They certainly, when it's time to work together, you see a far more creative response to things. And then the final step in a Kidnastics series is performing. And you may be scratching your head saying, what, we're gonna do gymnastics shows every day? What's this performing? The performing piece of Kidnastics really is a way for students to share what they've learned. And sometimes performing is simply as simple as you're going to show your series to another pair. And that's the performance piece of it. But you want to create and refine your sequence. And it really gives some sort of end. There's an end to when the practice occurs. We're going to demonstrate this and perform it in 5 minutes. So you're going to work on this and see what you can accomplish and get smooth in just a small amount of time and then show it off. And what I've found is that many children of all abilities love to perform. They love to show their movements. If any of you have ever spent a lot of time teaching gymnastics, you'll know that as a gymnastics student, people are always like, show me, you know, let me show you, let me show you. They want to show you what they do. And it's really sort of a natural inclination. So I think that that piece of demonstrating what you know is really a key piece of motivation. Now, just so you know what we're going to do today, we're not going to focus on hanging and climbing just by the virtue of the complexity of the environment. I didn't want to set it up in there knowing that you had so much to do today. So we're going to focus as best we can, we'll see how far we get with this, on rolling, jumping, balancing, and vaulting. And by the end of our lesson today, you are going to create a series, and you're going to have a chance to actually demonstrate your series. So hopefully you'll find that enjoyable. And really my point too is to give you a little overview of what each of the movement categories includes, and then you can be thinking how you would use that activity with your own students here. So I'll briefly just have you look at the slide, but know that you're going to get to live this, so you don't need to commit this to memory or anything. But when we look at rolling, obviously rolling involves rotation, and it can be along the long axis or the short axis, and it can be asymmetrical. Rotation obeys all the rules of efficiency principles in that, such as roundness, and as you get smaller, it speeds up rotation. So good rollers can do many different roles in many different environments. And obviously rolling also has some implications for safety. It's important to have your kind of students jumping and landing from any sort of height. They might want to know how to roll as a proper way to fall. So rolling is an important thing to teach early on. And some of the environments that you might choose to roll on include uphill and downhill sort of mat stacks, going across panel mats, going onto mats, going off a rope and rolling, even doing something as simple as sitting in a chair and rolling off a chair helps get people in the right body position. Again, to modify something, I'd say down, roll downhill, tends to be a bit easier. Have a child roll up in a blanket, gives them more sort of tactile feeling of what they're doing. And then as mentioned before, you can have your students practice rolling while holding a ball either in their belly, between their legs, and by virtue of doing that, they're going to be in the correct body position. I think balancing, you're going to find, is a really important area to work on because it just has such a huge impact on movement in general. So we're going to look at both static and dynamic balance and a little bit of inverted balance. We're not going to do a ton of inverted balance, but if you think about how you could address a range of student responses, if you can do anything from balancing on two knees to doing handstands, it really does allow for quite a range of abilities. We'll go through balancing. We're going to look at jumping, and obviously with jumping, we need to focus first on good landings and what that means, and then with jumping, we're going to challenge ourselves to jump to a spot, to jump for distance, to jump into a target. All those things will be we're going to introduce just five basic jumps today, and then when you think about how do you change your environment, well, what do you want students to be able to do with the jump? Well, you want them to be able to jump on and off things. You want them to jump in different patterns. You might want to use lines. Students jump over a line back and forth. And obviously a modification for teaching jumping initially could be to use some sort of rebounding surface. You need to think about, well, what surface is easy or more difficult for a particular student. And then vaulting actions, I think you'll have a lot of fun with this because it really, a vaulting action by kidnastic definition is simply moving with weight on your hands. You're moving from one place to another by putting weight in your hands, which really opens up a huge range of activities. And we're going to do primarily some animal movements today. And keep in mind that we're also going to get into your sort of traditional vaulting and wheeling and cartwheeling. We'll spend a lot more time on all the animal movements, because I think you'll see that by doing different movements, you're going to be able to really get quite a physical response from your students. It's going to really work on lots of things that they have goals for. Just the final thought before we start moving, you might say, okay, why gymnastics? You know, can't we just achieve some of the goals that we have for our students by doing other activities? Well, I want you to think about a few things. Gymnastics, one, really teaches body management. Clearly, it's a way to focus on muscular strength, muscular endurance. I would bet when you're done with what we do today, even just with the vaulting actions, your arms will be tired. You're going to feel it in your abs. It's going to require that you really keep good body position. Certainly, it's a way to work on flexibility. And as you work here, you want to be thinking very closely about, well, what is it, what parts of the body that I'm trying to either stretch, where is there tension that we need to work on, and so what movement do I need to have my child go through multiple times to achieve that? It's much more fun to pretend you're a bear and you're moving around the mat than sometimes to do a static stretch and hold it. So really, it's very motivating for kids. And really, I'd say the biggest reason I love gymnastics, I think it's an important thing to work on with children, is that it really involves the whole person. Particularly if you use a kidnastic or an educational gymnastics approach, you're asking a child to be creative with movement, you're asking them to work cooperatively, and you're asking them to make decisions about how they want to move. So really, you have the psychomotor domain is being used, the affective domain, the cognitive domain. So really, you're really looking at total development. And clearly, it's a creative process, depending on how you present it, and addresses problem solving. So with this approach, we really see movement in its fullest potential. So with that, I guess what I'll ask first is, I'm sure I'll say, do you have any questions? And no one will say anything, but we'll ask. Do you have any questions you'd like to ask at the moment? I don't bite or anything, really. So, how many people in here have done gymnastics before? Raise your hand. How many people in here, I don't know if we'd want to ask this, don't right now think, I don't like gymnastics. We have a little fear about it. Okay, usually in a class of gymnastics, there's quite a few people that say, oh, gymnastics, yuck, I had a horrible experience with it. So hopefully your experience will be positive as we go into the gymnasium. Ready? Go. Traveling around. Go, go, go.
As
very careful with that. So we have four mats to use. We can actually get more of you on the mats. You have your own self space. All right, we're going to start with what we call vaulting actions. And again, vaulting actions, any action that you are moving with from one place to another with your hands. Now, the first thing we're going to do today, we're all laying down our bellies. On your belly. Here we go. All right. And we're going to do what we call an alligator crawl. All right, this is appropriate for me with the Super Bowl going on. We're thinking about Florida. We're going to do an alligator crawl. And an alligator crawl, we really use our forearms and we use our legs. If you notice, my feet are out to the side. I'm really using the my inner thighs and my arms. So I'm going to have you alligator crawl. I want you to alligator crawl to the count of 15 and then tag off your partner. I got the part and then I'll take turns. Ready? Go. Alligator crawl. If you feel, okay, alligator crawl. Nice to see you. Nice to see some alligators here. Trying to be out, your feet are in. You're gonna really feel it.
Oh yeah, you're too short.
You are so happy. You're young. You are actually a young lad. You're not. Now, puppies become a butterfly. like goofing all around. So you need to keep head down because dogs are always looking at your environment. Okay? So you're a happy puppy. Ready? Go. Happy puppy. Oh, look at a happy puppy. Look up. Ready? Go. summertime, and you've come across a whole bunch of bunnies, all right? I want everyone to get into the position that you are a rabbit, okay? And this is actually a little bit more advanced move. You're gonna have to be careful with how you do this because you need a spot to jump forward. But if we're gonna do bunny hops, we're gonna reach our hands out in front of us and then pull the legs between the hands. So we're using both sides of the body. It's actually a bunny jump because it's 2 feet, not a bunny hop. So hands go out here, we pull the feet in. Now, that's a fairly complicated movement. If I'm gonna use this with, you know, if I'm using this to teach some movement, I'm not gonna start with a bunny hop right away. Again, I would probably go with the alligator crawl and build up to this. So hands here and reach forward, hands here, reach forward. And again, head and eyes go up and think about pulling both feet at the same time. So you need to make sure that you have a clear vision, so turn out most of you. And what I'd like you to do is I want you to practice bunny hopping. Do 5 bunny hops and then stop. Ready? Go. Make sure to clear view. Keep your head here, not even with your chest. break from that. That's a challenging movement. You can feel it in your arms. It takes a ton of body control. If you want to get your students to do that, you probably have to hold them in a position, do things like they're going to hold here. I mean, that's tough. That's not an easy position. You might put them underneath them initially. But this is really going to require a lot of strength and coordination to actually move this way. And then obviously now to make it a more creative process, then you say, let's do it in unison. Let's change the direction that we do it in to really allow the student to explore that. Now, can you imagine them trying to do a crab walk or any of those movements on a different surface? You do it on the benches. You do it over the climbing frame. So then you think, how do I do it in a different environment? If we were doing this in our gymnastics class, I would have mats out here and benches. People might be doing things over or under, just to be more, a little bit more creative. All right, you're off the hook. Send the next one in, right? Can I ask, as this group comes on, would you grab a hula hoop and bring a hula hoop to your own space, please? You don't have to do hula hooping, I promise.
Jumping through it.
I promise. Now, obviously, we just finished a theme. That was all on vaulting. Vaulting actions include also doing all your cartwheels, roundoffs, vaulting over things. Okay, so you have your own hoop. Excellent. Find your own space and sit down in your space, balancing on two body parts. Balance the two body parts in your own space. If you don't have hoops, that's okay too. You'll be all right. I like to use hoops when you're doing balancing because it restricts the area. It really depends to be a balance. In theory, there has to be some instability. There has to be, in what thought might be different with the balance for you. If the movement is so stable for you that you don't have to even think about it, you don't really have to balance it. However, you may have a child that you're working with that standing, obviously standing, is a huge balance issue. Huge. So be thinking that balance needs to be the thing. So here you are, you're practicing balancing in your hoop, and we do all sorts of fun things. We're going to do some static balances first. I'd like you to make an in with your body. Belly in your hoop. You lay down in your hoop like this. Belly in the middle. Ha ha. You're like this.
hold that position. Obviously, you know, lack of body strength to accomplish this, you know, you can go back on the line. In your feet. When you think about, we've done it, remember them. Put, link three balances together. Each time you do a balance, hold it for at least 3 seconds. Ready? Practice. Make sure it makes sense what your transition is. Do the movements logically together. So you're doing three balances, so you can link together. Here's the movement, and what you want to begin to have your children think about is, how does one movement lead to another? What's a smooth transition? And to be a smooth transition, you have to have control of your body. Do you each have a series? Okay, what I'd like you to do now is partner up with someone. I want you to show them your series, and they'll then mirror you. They'll do it. They'll show you theirs, and then we're going to link the 6 of them together. Okay? Find a partner. Show them. When you are performing, what do you have to do in order to time cues in your environment at the time you're moving. You looked at your partner, you may have spoken about it, okay? Anything else when you're performing? It seemed like to me, like you were thinking. You were thinking about the movement. Also, as a performer, I was like, okay, now I go this way, and now I do this. And that is a big piece of the creative process. We want your brain to be involved. We want you to be thinking about your movement as you do it. So that's clearly a piece that the Kidnastics coach brings into it. I don't know if you also noticed, but when I said, okay, practice, one, there was sort of, oh no, I've got a show to do in a minute. Okay, and they sort of rushed to get their things together. And two, they began to talk and interact around what they were doing. And oftentimes, when people work together, they are helping each other. They're trying something that maybe they couldn't do before. They are helping each other, potentially even giving some cues around them. So thank you very much for that. Let's quickly, I'm going to give one more minute. That was just the balancing theme. And I do want to go really quickly into just a few roles, all right? So what I'd like you to do is sit right in your hoop. We'll keep saying this about here, okay? Sit in your hoop, so you're sitting in your seat. And let's just practice rolling just back and forth. Back and forth in your hoop. Actually, it could be kind of painful. So, why don't you take your hoop and put it behind you, get rid of your hoop, okay? And you turn it right.
Unfortunately, it's at 7:30 in the morning.
on Monday and Wednesday, but next fall,